So first off, kind of cover the types of county governments in Maryland. And there are 24 counties in the state, 23 counties plus Baltimore City, which legally counts as both a county and an incorporated city. And of these 24 counties, there are three types of county governments. You have commission form of government, which has six counties in it: Calvert, Carroll, Garrett, St. Mary, Somerset, and Washington. You have the charter form of government, which has 12 counties in it: Anne Arundel, Baltimore City, Baltimore County, Cecil, Dorchester, Frederick, Hartford, Howard, Montgomery, Prince George's, Talbot, Wicomico, and finally, code home rule counties. There's six of those: Allegheny, Caroline, Charles, Kent, Queen Anne's, and Worcester. And if you go, it's interesting to note there's a broad range here, particularly in the charter class. There is no particular partisan or size requirement. You have small to mid-sized counties as commission counties, small to mid-sized counties as code home rules, and some small, mid, and large counties as charters. And you have some very liberal or progressive counties with charter forms of government. You also have some very conservative counties with charter forms of government. So there is no single partisan or political connection to any of these forms. So I think the next question is, why do we have three forms of county government? And then there's two, I think, key points to understanding that. The first is Maryland counties are extremely diverse and have vastly different local needs and demographics. And in a way, that's both a blessing and a curse, but we have much higher diversity within our counties than almost every other state. A couple of factoids. The estimated total population as of July 1st, 2016 for Montgomery County is over 1 million people as number one, all the way down to Kent County, which is barely pushing 20,000 people. St. Mary's is ranked in the middle at 12th with 112,000 people. Same thing with population density. Baltimore City with over 7,600 people per square mile is number one, all the way down to Garrett County, which has the extremely sparse 45 people per square mile. So if you don't like lots of people, don't like lots of breathing room, Garrett County may be the place for you. Again, St. Mary's is kind of ranked in the middle at 13. You have 314 people per square mile. Finally, look at your budgets. For the approved FY 2016 operating budgets, Prince George's County has the highest with $2.95 billion, all the way down to Somerset County on the Eastern Shore with an annual budget of $35.2 million. Again, St. Mary's falls into the middle with an annual budget of $227 million. So what's the one takeaway from this? One size does not fit all. And that's why you have differing governments. The other answer to that question is Maryland counties are very unique in the nation in that they are either mandated by the state or have powers to provide services that go far beyond what most other counties and most other states provide. And I'm not going to go through each piece here, but just be aware your county governments fund your community colleges. They issue debt. They do a variety of general government support, including supporting the judiciary, running elections, financial administration, legal, personnel, alcoholic beverage control. They fund and maintain local health departments. They fund and maintain your public schools, K-12 education. They're responsible for a broad array of land use, planning, development, zoning, and economic development. They fund libraries. They provide public safety, either through sheriff's offices, police departments, and EMS services. They do public works, road maintenance, and infrastructure maintenance, and they run parks and recreation facilities. So this is a huge laundry list of tasks on which they have to do. And again, the idea has been multiple types of governments are needed to best fit the needs of your county. So now I'm going to kind of talk about the different forms of government, starting with commission. This is the original form of county government and was used by all counties except Baltimore City up until the early 20th century. And not surprisingly, and St. Mary's is obviously a commission government, and you're governed by a group of county elected officials called commissioners. And per the Maryland Constitution, A commission county can only legislate in areas where the General Assembly has given them authority. And while these areas have increased over time, they're still more narrowly construed than that of a charter or code home rule county. And a General Assembly can enact legislation affecting a single commission county, and exact powers do vary from commission county to commission county because of this. So some of the examples recently, and this was compiled by the state's Department of Legislative Services, and looking from 2011 to 2014, they assembled a list of some of the areas where the General Assembly has been involved with commission counties. You have regulation of local roads, sale of county property, fees to water, sewer service, solid waste disposal, abatement of nuisances, salaries and benefits of county officers and employees, term limits and the filling of vacancies in a board of county commissioners, litter control, animal control, and at least in one county, a repeal of a local ban on fortune telling. So moving to the charter form of government, and I'm just going to really provide a little bit here for context. This was the second form of government for counties in Maryland. It was created in 1915, and it was done primarily to reduce the glut of local measures that the General Assembly had to deal with, and as a result, many of them got unpassed in the final days of the legislative session. And two, it was also to allow local legislation to be enacted solely by those directly affected. The authority for a charter form of government is found in the Maryland Constitution, and it requires the General Assembly to grant express powers to charter counties to legislate certain matters. The county is limited to matters expressly described in this grant of powers, and that is found in Title 10 of the Maryland Code's Local Government article. And it basically is a list of the powers that are reserved to charter counties. A charter county's basic form of governmental structure is laid out in a document called a county charter, and it's really analogous to a constitution. Most charter counties have a county council and a county executive, but several do work through kind of a county council, county manager form instead. The General Assembly cannot pass laws affecting a single charter county if the subject is contained in the express powers grant, but may do so if it affects two or more charter counties. And so in the Maryland Code, you will see some strange groupings of counties as legislation was passed. And that brings us to the third and final form, and the one which you're considering, that is the Code Home Rule form of government. This was created in 1966 by a constitutional amendment, and really is kind of, I think, on the spectrum. If you have the commission county at one end of the spectrum, the charter county at the other, Code Home Rule sort of falls into the middle. A code county has broad authority to enact public local laws without the need for a charter. And the code county's legislative authority is found both in the Maryland Constitution and in the Maryland Code. A county that opts to become a code county may organize parts of its government, reorganize parts of its government, but it does not have to dramatically change it. And some have never really changed much and retain the basic commissioner structure. Now, what constitutes a public local law? That's been kind of subject to some debate, and the Office of the Attorney General in Maryland has stated that the code county's authority should be broadly construed. Now, in practice, code home rule counties may enact legislation in similar areas to charter counties, although the procedures pertaining to certain areas, such as, say, indebtedness, are somewhat different. And unlike commissioner and charter counties, the General Assembly must enact laws applicable to code home rule counties as a class. And it may not enact laws that only apply to a single county, code county, unless there is only one code county in that class. And the classes the General Assembly have created are based on geography. Right now, there are four classes: Central Maryland, the Eastern Shore, Southern Maryland, and Western Maryland. So this means that right now, Charles County is the only code county in Southern Maryland. So the General Assembly can basically pass legislation affecting just that county because it's the only one there. Allegheny County is similar out in western Maryland. But in the other areas of the state where you have multiple code counties, they have to enact legislation that affects all of those counties within that one geographic class. So if St. Mary's were to become a code county, then the General Assembly could only pass legislation that affects them and Charles County since they're in that same class. And note, this just applies at the state level for what the General Assembly does. If Charles County is a code county, or St. Mary's was to become a code county, local legislation passed in Charles County would have no effect on St. Mary's County and vice versa, just as it is now, that those are your local laws. There is one exception to this class requirement, and that is the General Assembly may set a maximum property tax rate or level of indebtedness for a specific code county. However, to date, they have never exercised that authority. So that's kind of the broad scope of the three types of government. I'm now going to walk through some specific issues, and I know I have submitted, and I believe it is online available along with these slides, a chart that provides much more detail about these differences, not only for code, home rule, and commissioner counties, but it also includes how it would work in a charter county. So I'm just going to kind of go through several, and starting with body authority. So in a commission county, the General Assembly must specifically authorize any bonds that are to be issued, and there's no statutory limitation on the amounts. For a code home rule, the county commissioners would authorize the bonding level. There is no statutory maximum, but as I noted, the General Assembly may establish a limit. This is also, though, subject to a local referendum if petitioned by 10% of the voters. So that is different from a commission county in that there's a specific referendum provision provided for setting a limit on bonding. In the term of tax caps, for a commissioner county, the General Assembly may establish that. But for a code home rule, it is up to the county commissioners. County commissioners may not enact, and the General Assembly may, however, enact a tax cap for a code county. So there's no difference there. It's the General Assembly's call on tax caps. For referendum, for a commission county, public local laws in a commission county are subject to a referendum if petitioned by 10% of the registered voters. The General Assembly may enact public local laws contingent on the approval of by referendum. For a code home rule county, all legislation is subject to a referendum if there's a petition filed with the Board of Election Supervisors by 10% of the registered voters. So again, not too much difference there. In terms of enacting new taxes, licenses, or franchise fees for a commissioner county, the General Assembly authorization is needed. But for a code home rule, General Assembly authorization is also required. And you cannot create new taxes, license, or franchise fees that are not authorized at the time the county got its home rule status. So if, for example, St. Mary's County is a commissioner county now, they have an impact fee that's currently in existence that was authorized by the General Assembly, and they have the county commissioners have the authority to modify that fee. If they changed over to a code home rule, they would retain the authority to modify that fee because it pre-existed the time of changing over. But if they wanted to create a new fee or something different, they would still then have to go to the General Assembly. So again, broadly, no real difference there. In terms of impact fees, the commissioners, General Assembly must establish and we authorize the use of impact fees in a commissioner county, but in a code home rule county, it's up to the commissioners to establish. Similar with tax credits, in both instances, General Assembly authorization is needed to provide tax credits, both for commission and code home rule. For planning and zoning authority, it's pretty much the same. You're subject to state law, and no type of county really has a lot of flexibility with land use. That remains a power of the state. in terms of declaring or levying civil penalties, infractions, or fees for enforcement of laws. For a commissioner county, the General Assembly must specifically authorize. For a code home rule county, the county commissioners may enact, but it is subject to certain limitations. For excise taxes, the General Assembly must authorize for a commission county. And for a code home rule, the commissioners may enact a school construction excise tax up to $750 per lot if it is not already levying a development impact fee. Additionally, they may also enact an agricultural excise tax up to $750 per lot for the purchase of transferable development rights if the county is not levying a development impact fee already. So there are a few restrictions there as to what can be done locally. Turning to kind of the formality of the legislative process and procedures, there are little differences here. For Commissioner County, it's largely informal. There's no provision that specifically covers setting of legislative days, how the county handles emergency bills, or publication of proposed bills. That's pretty much decisions made up to the county. But for a code home rule, there is a little more formality, and the annotated code of the state does specify the precise format, the maximum number of legislative sessions, how public notification is to occur, provisions on how emergency bills are handled, effective dates, publication of proposed bills, etc. So there is actually a tweak in the law where code home rule has a little more requirements than a commissioner county does. In terms of the number of commissioners or council members and their method of election, the General Assembly for a commissioner county will set the compensation. There is an informal salary board that may be established to make recommendations to the General Assembly, but ultimately it's the General Assembly that decides the compensation. For a code home rule, the commissioners may enact a recommendation of a salary commission that is established by ordinance. Finally, the ability to establish separate police and corrections departments. For a commissioner county, again, you have to get General Assembly approval. For a code home rule, a corrections department or warden may be done through enactment by the commissioners through a public local law, but if you want to establish a police department, it still requires General Assembly approval. So kind of, I know I threw a lot of examples at you. Again, all of the details are in the charts that should be available online with this presentation. But kind of broad line, what are the advantages and drawbacks of each form? Well, commission is the oldest form. It's the most simple for a small to mid-sized county. It can work very well. The advantages of the code home rule are you have a little more local autonomy in some areas. You still have to go to the General Assembly for a number of critical things, but there are some things that your commissioners can make decisions on. And it really, unlike a charter form of government, doesn't really require you to have a dramatic upheaval of your county government. You can retain your commission structure and not have a lot of changes. Before I turn this over to questions, a couple of other specific questions that I'd previously gotten that I want to pre-answer. One is, if the county changes form of government and citizens don't like it, can they change back or to another form? And the answer is yes. I'm not aware of any county in the history of the state that has done that, but there's no provision in the law that does not prohibit bringing a new proposal, putting it to referendum, and changing form. The other issue that seems to be asked here is, if the county changes over to a code home rule form of government, can they set term limits on Board of Education members? And the answer to that is no. They would have to go to the General Assembly and have a statute passed to change or set term limits for Board of Education members. So with that, I'm going to conclude and provide you a couple of other sources of information and my contact information. I'm happy to answer questions from both the audience here or anybody who has seen this online and wishes to contact me. I will do my best to provide answers to your questions.
Let's see. I think we only have one individual signed up, Keith Harless. Okay, Please come forward to the podium, state your name and address for the record, and speak clearly into the microphone as the hearing is being videotaped for a later broadcast.
Good evening. My name is Keith Harless. I'm at 23225 Murfield Lane, Lexington Park, Maryland. And as you know, I've attended most of the hearings on Code Home Rule, watched a couple on TV. It's like to thank you for having Mr. Knapp's presentation. It was very informative, and having him down here a couple times answer questions and everything. It was very educational. Now we've gone through many hearings, so I've started to step back and think about, so what have we really learned? Legislature still has to create any new taxes or fees, no matter which way. Commissioners still set the local rates each way. Currently, the local laws changes have to go to the legislature. The other way, they wouldn't. But from what we've seen, the commissioners still find a way to make this work within the current framework to get things done their own way to help benefit the citizens of St. Mary's County. So there hasn't seemed to be any great impact there. Looking at this year, so I wanted to stop and take a second and look back at some of these things that and how this process works. So we had the county local law review that takes place in the fall before going to the state legislature. And this year there were quite a few items on that. There wasn't really much of a presentation of any given to the public about them. Just kind of read the names of them and the year and said they were old and that's why we should get rid of them. But in this country, we have a lot of old laws that are still good, still relevant. And so just because something's old doesn't mean we need to throw it out if it's still good and relevant to things. So I think communications is a big key to that, and that's been talked about, and that and if there was a more of an explanation of why you wanted to rescind these and the impact of the change and just more explanation to the public, communication to the public on why these things were really wanted, that would help, but there really wasn't. And so there was just seemed to be a lot of lack of vetting of these things, and so, but it was nice because this year, so the next step was then things went to the state legislature. And I understand that 8 things were then sent to the state legislature and 7 of them got through. So that seems like a pretty good rate. That also seems like what that really helped us do is to focus on what's really important to us. You know, instead of just having this big wish list and not taking the time to really step through things and vet things out with the stakeholders and that gave us a real chance to focus on things, to be able to explain to the state legislators what it is we wanted and why we wanted it. And that, I think, really helps in the process. That brings us to the budget.
Keith, your 3 minutes is up.
Okay. Well, I just want to say thank you very much. I see that there's really no difference in I think the effectiveness of this, and that there's, I don't really see a compelling reason to change. And thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, on the Mr. Harless was able to address a few things here, but I just wanted to maybe add some clarification to some of the comments that you gave. So on the local laws that we recommended to be rescinded and or passed, they had been presented to the citizens of the county for 6 to 8 years to the delegation, yearly to the delegation as they changed back when Senator Dyson was there and Johnny Wood. All of the same exact bills. In total, there was 18 actually over from 6 to 8 years. The delegation chose not to do anything with them for those six 6 to 8 years. The county attorneys, through that time, continued to try and press through and get them passed. No, they went nowhere. Last year, only 3 bills were actually passed for St. Mary's County out of the 18 that we submitted. They were rescinding laws that the state had actually superseded. So the laws that were on the books that the county had were actually outdated because the state actually governed that area at the point. So it created conflict with the county and the state because obviously the state law supersedes what the county had at that point. So it needed to be cleaned up so there was no conflict in that area. Those are the only 3 from the county that passed. The other one, which was the 4th one, was for the Metropolitan Commission. So on the vetting, now this year, yes, I will agree with you that because we originally did not plan to have the joint legislative session, that the presentation again of the same set of bills was not presented again. So we went forward and we had it and we scheduled the meeting. And the same information that was given out for previous years was not done in the same, I guess, efficient manner, because we did not intend on having that same meeting. The overall flow through Annapolis to here, it is a cumbersome one at times. You have to deal with a lot of different personalities when it comes to St. Mary's County, and that is difficult. People that, for the most part, don't understand St. Mary's County. The ability to lessen the burden of our legislators and let them work on higher level issues while not having to worry about the lower level issues in St. Mary's County is one that I'm very keen on. There's things that they could be focusing on for us without worrying about the medial tasks, which after going up there and watching what they have to go through to rescind a law for basically, let's say it's fox hunting or it's even something for the court. They spend hours, if not days, in committees on something that is very low level when they could be focusing on bigger changes for St. Mary's County. It really is amazing to see what they have to go through for the various different committees. So I think that this for me is a two-way street. It's lessening the burden on the local level and letting them focus on the bigger issues as a team, so we can go ahead and actually have a bigger impact in Annapolis when we need something on a larger level done. Because out of those 18, there were larger level bills that we couldn't get done because they were focusing on smaller ones, and they also had other state level issues to deal with at the same time. So that's sort of the other side of where I see it. So I have to respect their positions in Annapolis of what they're doing, and try and see their role from that as well. One of the other things that was brought up through many of these hearings was the fact of a police department. Now, you didn't bring it up, but it's come up multiple times. And seeing how this is the last one, I just want to make sure it's clear and on the record is that, you know, with this code home rule, there's no way that we're allowed to start local law enforcement. The sheriff's department is our law enforcement agency. So, you know, a lot of people have approached multiple commissioners and said that. So we cannot start a police department. We can't do anything, a municipal police department. So the sheriff's department is it. That's who's going to be here. We're proud to have them, and they're going to stay there.
Okay, there's no other sign up. Does anyone else wish to speak out there? Would like to get up and,
ma'am, please approach and
please give your name and address and.
Hi, my name is Ruth Wise, 23834 Point Lookout Road, Leonardtown, and I don't really have anything to say. I was just curious when you mentioned there were higher level laws that didn't get passed. Could you give us an example of one?
Oh, there was plenty of bills up in Annapolis. I don't have all 18 in front of me to go through them. We were working on ones for, I believe we had stuff with Metropolitan Commission.
That was passed.
We got the No, that was their specific bill.
Their specific one. Well, there's one, for example, like fox hunting that is covered by DNR and their regulation, and is still in our local regulation. We were just trying to get that eliminated. And that didn't go anywhere. just for example. These are just things that we would clean up in our legislative laws. Anyone else? Well, it would be able to do it here locally versus send it to our legislators up in Annapolis. Right. Well, by here, we have a procedure to do it here. Yes, exactly.
Yeah, and what happens is when we have the ability to legislate locally on these laws, we're able to draft the bill here. One of our names actually gets attached to it. So it adds to accountability. Right now, there's no accountability. If I decide and I woke up tomorrow that I wanted to have an ordinance drafted and I walked into the county attorney and I said, I have this great idea. Can you draft an ordinance? And then he said, sure, I'll draft an ordinance. And then it floats through all the commissioners. And they say, yeah, that's a great idea. And then it gets put on the agenda and it comes forward. The citizens have no idea whose idea it was, who co-sponsored it. It just happens to get all the votes, and that's it. So there's no accountability on that part of whose idea was this coming forward. With a bill that we would present, it would say Commissioner John O'Connor is the one that actually drafted this or sponsored it, and then I would have co-sponsors to that legislation. So it tracks actually who brought all these laws forward during our legislative session. The other portion is... with other portions of the bills, with the higher level, what I'm talking about is the state laws that I would love our legislators and senators to be able to deal with, rather than focus on the local laws that we could focus on. So we're talking about Maryland Department of the Environment, dealing with permits and regulations, Department of Natural Resources. We were talking Bay Restoration Funds, allocation of... revenue for highway user revenues. There's lots of other things that they can worry about for St. Mary's County and help us in that avenue. To ask them, can you please rescind the fox hunting, or can you go ahead and I think one of them we asked actually was one of the bills they rescinded was peddlers, and the other one was taxi cabs. I think it was taxi cabs and peddlers that were the two that went through this time, where we could have actually held it here and rescinded it and just taken care of it. And that would have freed up time for them to handle other measures.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak?
Could you clarify about the fox hunting? Because you keep bringing that up, and it's not really so much about fox hunting, but it's more about the molesting and not being able to shoot fox hounds while they're out. And so, you know.
Is that right, George?
Well, it didn't go anywhere, but the...
Georgia.
Well, quite frankly, Mr. Harless, if someone was to wantonly shoot a foxhound while I was chasing a fox, I think it would be in violation of the criminal law article that prohibits cruelty to animals. So that's kind of the classic example of how a state law, which makes perfectly good sense, has now overridden a very old and archaic and frankly useless county law that we just want to get off the books, because in constructing and reconstructing our county code, which has not really been comprehensively addressed since 1978, the general philosophy is both to modernize and limit the number of laws that affect and restrict St. Mary's Countyans. The government that governs least frequently governs best. So that's what we're trying to accomplish.
Anyone else have anything else to say? Uh-oh. Right now, the audience who showed up a little late here is Senator Waugh, Steve, from representing Calvert, then St. Mary's County.
Hey, gentlemen. Senator. Mr. President, nice to see you. I did want to come. I called, left a couple messages. I guess we just didn't connect effectively. Okay. I have put together a few thoughts, if you wouldn't mind. I've just got a couple of slides I can show you and walk you through. And what I want to try to help you all out is just to give you a little bit of a different perspective from the resources that we've got on our hands, to give you some other thoughts on Code Home before you move forward. recognize that it's your decision and that it needs to be handled by you. I just want to try to give you guys the benefit of whatever I've seen.
Can you do it in 3 minutes?
I can do it really fast.
Go ahead. You got it. All right. 3 minutes.
We'll cut you a break.
Yeah. We might give you 4 if it goes over 3. All right, maybe. Maybe. Just maybe.
If we can just get that up really quick. Say I'm a what? Oh, yes, yes.
Delegation.
Yeah, you represent the delegation.
I represent. How about this? I represent the Senate delegation.
Oh,
there you go.
We don't have that much time.
It'll be easy to get through. Anyway, I understand that y'all have been wrestling with this, and you've had a number of public hearings, and that a number of folks have expressed their concerns or hopes for where Code Home might go. And I think there's a lot of information out there. Much of it, I think, is less definitive than perhaps you might like. So I tried very hard to peel this onion back as best as I could in Annapolis. And some of the folks that I pulled on are the Department of Legislative Services, and specifically we have a couple of lawyers who are concerned with this question. So I actually did my own research. I'm an APL guy, what can I say? And wrote up a white paper, gave it to Georgiana, the lady who's the specialist, and she came in and said, yeah, okay, you basically have got that right. So what I want to show you is essentially what I have found and what I think are the high points and things that you all ought to consider as you're moving forward. Not going to tell you which way to go. That's your decision, as well it should be, and certainly respect that as your senator. Does anybody know a good joke? But anyway,
this is going to go over 3 minutes. It's taking a long time to look.
You know, you can't count the boot time here. It'll be fast. There are a number of questions that have come up, and things that Commissioner O'Connor's been talking about, as far as which bills that we need to be pushing from your legislative delegation up in Annapolis. And just to clarify, I mean, at our legislative meeting, you guys did have a lot, and we just didn't want to swamp ourselves all at once, so we did phase those out. And we did ask whether or not any of them were time critical, and none of them were. So we picked the ones that we thought were easy, and we could start with those and get those done. And I think we have the other ones phased out. We should do another 8 next year and another 8 next year. Now, unless you guys need to rephase that, or you have new ideas and other things that you want to push, then we can reorder and try again. So, you know, that's all on the table. Okay. All right. Pretty picture of the front. Wow, that's some cool
screen. That Leonard Town?
Yeah. All right. Next slide for me. All right. So what I've seen in looking at your website, fundamentally what you're telling everyone and what Commissioner O'Connor has said is that the purpose here is to react quickly and being able to handle things locally. And I think as good, small government Republicans, everyone likes the idea that the government that's closest to us is probably going to be best for us. And I think that's a decent concept. And then the backstop that you've been telling everyone is hey, Code Home, we're not going to have the authority to enact new taxes or fees under Code Home rule. And I think those things are largely true, but perhaps limited in ways that you had not been aware of. The truth is that you will get very little local authority, a lot less than you might imagine, and I can give you some concrete examples of that. It's not to say that it's bad, it's just you got to ask yourself whether or not it's worth the trouble. The other thing is you need to understand that in the future, as a Code Home county, you will be in a class with Charles County, which means you are married to Charles County for all future legislative requests. So that has certain implications. And the other thing is, and probably the really biggest single change with Code Home, is that the county would get unlimited debt authority. Now, is that good? Is that bad? You get unlimited debt authority. So for me, bottom line, you probably end up with major new debt because that is the arc of all of the other code counties. And what I would tell you from personal experience is that speed breeds mistakes in legislation. And the other part is that while, yeah, voters can petition, it is virtually impossible, and I'll show you how that works. Next, please. All right, so think of this as a filter. You start out with the Express Powers Act. There's about 30 things that you could do, except. Except for the stuff that the state expressly says we're going to do, except for the stuff that's implied preemption, and except for the stuff that's preemption by conflict. Good luck getting anyone to give you a firm list on what you're left with. It's very, very difficult. I asked about six different lawyers, and everyone kind of gave me a shrug. No one could nail it down. That's somewhat frustrating. So let's look at a practical example next. Charles County last year, which is a code county, passed seven, count them, seven legislative items. That was it. And in the year prior, they only passed a few extra. So the breadth of this is not very large. And in fact, I've got it out in my truck, is the Charles County code. And we tabbed in there everywhere that they passed some legislation, that they made a change to their law. And it's not in a lot of places. There's a whole lot of space that is still going to be reserved to Annapolis, and you're going to have to go to the state to get changes. And that's just the way that it works. So this is why I'm saying this is actually very little authority. Yeah, you can do it. Yeah, you'll have control of it, but it's not a lot. And it will be a great deal of trouble to do it. Next, please. I guess it just doesn't like my script here. Anyway, you're not going to have authority to legislate in a number of areas. So last year, we had six code counties introduce 54 bills in 18 different articles of the code. So what I can tell you for sure is that you will not be able to legislate in these articles of the code. So for example, the fox hunting question. Hey, hunting, that's off the table. That's going to be reserved by Annapolis. It's going to stay up there regardless of whether or not you're a code or even a charter county, because the rules are essentially the same. So this is the stuff that you definitely cannot do. And that's actually easier for us to understand. Next, please. All right, the other part. You're going to get married to Charles County because you become a class within Southern Maryland. So theoretically, Calvert County, St. Mary's County, and Charles County are all one class. Well, right now, Charles is the only county in the class. So when they make a change, they just have to approve it by their legislators and their county commissioners. If St. Mary's becomes a code county, you become part of the class with Charles County. And then for a state legislator to make a change, for example, let's say that we want to do something as simple as the archery minimum safe distance, I have to get approval from the Charles County commissioners and the Charles legislative delegation before I can move that bill for you. So you're not really going to have your hands on the handlebars. You're going to take your hand off one and let Charles County put it on. So you're actually going to lose control of your legislation. You're going to get less control, not more. Next, please. All right, and then the unlimited debt. This is pretty clear. It's unambiguous if you were to look at the books on this. Local law authorizing debt does not need to be submitted to the voters. So net-net is that all the code counties end up with more debt, and most of them have a worse bond rating than St. Mary's does. So it's highly likely that you'll end up over time, and I'm not saying this is going to happen a year or even 5 years, but it will happen over time, is that St. Mary's will probably get loaded with debt, and you will probably end up with a higher interest rate as a result. And what we know is that based on your budget and your plans, we are probably talking about having to do a bond bill, not a bond bill, excuse me, but a debt authorization bill to expand the debt for St. Mary's as it is, if you guys remain on the curve that you put out in your last budget, which we're willing to do. But we got to talk about that. So next, please. All right. It's impossible to petition these things. Now, the law says, or actually the Constitution says, you only need 5% of your voters. But 5% of 70,000 is 3,500 people. That's a lot of registered voters. And by comparison, in 2012, when we had those four petitions for gay marriage, in-state tuition, illegal aliens, we only got 1,900 people. So the likelihood that anyone is ever going to be able to successfully petition you is close to zero. And in fact, no one has ever successfully petitioned any code county action anywhere in the state. So theoretically possible, but practically impossible. Next. The other risks. Let's talk about speed. Speed is not good with legislation. And we learned this the hard way. Two examples. HB 1013, this last one, this was the Democrat transportation plan bill that they came out and they had this finely tuned plan where they were going to wrest control of transportation planning from the governor. They came up with this beautiful formula that after they had introduced, after they voted out of committee, and after they handed it to the governor said okay, and it would cancel all of the transportation projects in every county, including the Democratic ones. Oops. So being able to make decisions fast is not necessarily a good thing. The other example I would give you is our own SB 1000, which was the judicial repeal, which we had considered right here and we thought was a very small thing and a local thing. And what damage could possibly be done by recalling this one chapter of public local law? I personally didn't think it was a problem until I got a letter from the chief judge of the Court of Appeals, which is the Supreme Court of the state of Maryland, who said, please don't pass this bill. You're going to have statewide implications on how we pay for clerks in other counties. Like, yikes. So doing things quickly can be a problem. And as Commissioner O'Connor was saying, legislation is hard. It's going to be a burden on your citizens because they got to be here to watch you guys do it. They got to talk to you. And then you're going to end up having to hire more lawyers. I mean, that's just a fact of life. Come up to Annapolis. You cannot swing a dead cat without hitting lawyers. There's a lot of them. You will need additional staff, I guarantee it. You do get an excise tax authority, but I think it's really incidental, and I don't think that that's really a problem. There is an untested General Assembly check on taxation, and this is interesting in that some future Board of Commissioners, I'm not saying y'all, I'm saying somewhere down the road, could theoretically try to raise property taxes. The General Assembly theoretically can stop them, but it's never been done. And then you would absolutely get absolute authority to change the composition of boards. So if you wanted to go from 5 commissioners to 9 or to 3, you can do it, and you can do it in 7 days. I'm not saying it's a good idea or a bad idea, but you would definitely get control of that. That's the one thing everyone agrees on. All right, next. So I just want to summarize. Sorry if I took more than 3 minutes. But what I think are the 3 big takeaways, or at least what I've seen, number one, you're going to get very little authority, a lot less than you might think. You're going to get married to Charles County, which I don't think is your intention. And you will end up with unlimited debt, which I don't know if that's the intent or a goal or just a side effect. But certainly that's part of it. Anyway, I just wanted to present this to you. This is what I've seen. This is what I've been able to come up with. And what I want to offer is the resources that I've got as your state senator. I want to help you guys. So if you have questions, if you have other things that you want me to research, if you want me to get some of the lawyers to come down from Department of Legal Services or some of the other experts to consult on this to answer some of the deeper questions, and I'm very happy to produce those people and try to get them down here. I'm looking forward to working with y'all. My only concern, truthfully, my only real concern here with Code Home at this point is that I'm afraid it's going to be a distraction for us for the next 6 months. I want to spend the next 6 months with y'all tuning a plan for where we're going to take St. Mary's County. But I think if we put Code Home out there, that's going to kind of soak up all of the air in the room, and it's going to make it more difficult for us to do some really good strategic planning.
Yeah.
So that, I mean, truthfully, that's the only real concern. As far as your state senator, I'm neither diminished nor expanded either way on Code Home. It really doesn't affect me. So this is not about me. I just wanted to inform you guys, and I hope you take it in the best spirit. Do you have any questions for me? I tried to talk fast.
Anybody?
No.
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 No. We're just trying to increase our efficiency, Senator. That's all we're trying to do, and really. And
I understand.
I'm looking at 18 counties already have a charter commission, Code Home rule. And just curious, just trying to speed things up. And it is unfortunate we presented 18 bills this past year. And
I think there are select things that you would find some additional speed, but I think the vast majority, and actually,
and
one
we're just thinking of taking things off of your plate. We want you to do the big things for us that we need. And as far as something like we talk about this fox hunting, which is part of it, but it's just since it's already duplicated in DNR, why do we have it on our books? And we were just trying to get it off. It's just a clean things up type thing.
Understand.
That's the only thing we were looking at.
I mean, I think that you definitely point out the facts that are contained in Mr. Knapp's presentation. I mean, it's more detailed. The one thing, just as far as after hiring more staff, I have to disagree with you on that. I've visited all the other counties that have code and charter. Mm-hmm. The only one that I would say that has a larger legal staff is Prince George's County and Anne Arundel, and based on the size of their population, the actual size of the government. The other ones maintain the staff that they have for the government that they have. It's all based on population and that size, so I don't see our staff growing for that. Charles County has been Code Home Rule for quite a few years. They have not hired any additional attorneys to handle any legislation that's come through. So I think factually speaking, that one's a little skewed, that we would have to hire more staff. So on that one,
I think it's great.
Well, I think that's, let's say that that's a matter of opinion.
Okay, yeah, okay. Yeah, it's a it could be a matter of opinion based on a lot of circumstances that would go into it. The one thing I think that's great that you presented for the people of the county is you cleared up a really big fact about the limited authority that we would have. And I'm glad that you did that, because one of the misnomers was that by going to code home rule, we were going to have this expansive, massive amount of power down here. And by you presenting this, I think that it's great, because the people really understand that the true authority when it comes to legislation at the higher level really does rest with the state, and that slow, tedious process that's up there. And that when it comes to the local laws, we are defined still in what we can and can't do, and that we do need to still work with our legislators and come to you. And just like with the indebtedness for our bonding authority, I mean, that's something that the board could easily say, you know what, we want to put a control measure in because we might not be here forever, so let's put a cap on that, and we'll set it, because that's a good measure to have. So that those are all control measures that could be put in place, and then work with and have a check and balance, so to speak, in that aspect. So I think they're great points that actually do add a lot of clarification to it. And yes, I do agree that you can't get anybody's finger down on exactly which laws do apply and don't apply. And Mr. Knapp did say that, because it is expansive as to the local laws to what you can and can't pass based on what the state has the authority. And it is defined what you can't. You can't legislate at the state level. So it is, and I do appreciate it, because there are some points in there that the people do need to consider.
What I would recommend to you is if you pull up the General Assembly website and look at the legislation for this last session, and pick a code county, any code county, and then see how many bills were submitted by those code counties. Like I said, we had 6 code counties. They submitted 54 delegation bills. So that tells me that there's still a tremendous amount of interaction that's going to happen. Mm. So you're never going to get past that. There's no way to get beyond it.
Right.
So the only question is, really, at least in my mind, the real question for you guys is Code Home authority worth the trouble and the cost? Because it's definitely going to be trouble and cost. It's more work. It's new work. It's different work. And it's going to be a burden not just on you, but on the citizens in the county. So if you think that authority is worth having, then by all means, go do it. But I would argue, I think it's small and shrinking, because every time, you know, there's no prohibition from the state passing a new law in a new article that basically wipes out another section of Code Home authority. There's no prohibition on that at all. And then anytime you have a court case that goes through and gets resolved on this, you're going to end up with conflicts, and they're all going to get resolved in the state. And, you know, I feel your pain. The state has the exact same problem with the feds. Every time the feds change something, you know, we're whipping in the wind at the end of their tail. So that, to me, is really the base question for you: is the authority worth the trouble? Because it's going to be some trouble. But if you have any more questions on that, if you need any help, need any more resource, I'm perfectly happy to put everything that we've got at your fingertips. I'm looking forward to working with you guys. I think we have a lot of great work that we can do. There's a lot of big projects, a lot of opportunities for us to really, really start kicking things here in St. Mary's. So thanks very much. I appreciate the time.
Thank you for coming by and giving us the information. Appreciate it very much.
Is there anyone else out there who'd like to speak or anything? You need to come to the microphone. We got to get this on. We're recording this. Sorry.
One of the points was real property tax, but I thought with Code Home Rule you couldn't pass new taxes.
Whenever we do a raise a tax, right now it's in the form of an ordinance, so we have a public hearing, just like property tax or the fire rescue tax. So if we were to raise the fire rescue tax or emergency service, it would be in the form of a bill.
So that's why you would see that there. So they have to put it in the form of a bill that gets presented, and that's why the tax was raised. So it's just a different form or vernacular of how they actually presented that tax to be raised. So that's why that bill was presented. Right now, before we signed the budget, we actually went to public hearing, the Emergency Services Support Fund. We're raising that tax to support the length of the LOSAP to support our volunteers in retirement and the advanced life support and the revolving fund that buys apparatus for our fire departments. So that's actually in an ordinance that reads out. If we were code home rule, it would be in the form of a bill.
The lady actually raises a really good question. And this is actually, it's a little more puzzling. And hopefully you downloaded the brief. If not, I'm going to post this on my my website, and I'll email it to you guys. And there's hyperlinks into everything, so it's easy to click on and find the individual pieces. But to answer your question, the real property tax increase was actually creation of a transfer tax in Charles County. And I believe, but this is not absolutely clear, when I read the legislation that they passed, they're pointing to some other state legislation, but when I go look for it, there's no specific authorization for Charles County to institute it. So I'm beginning to think that this might actually be one of those cases where a code county actually did create a tax when they're not necessarily supposed to. So there's fuzz on this one, and I don't want to say one way or another exactly which one, but it's confusing because their legislation actually does point to a state law and saying, here it is in this article, you know, title, subtitle, whatever. And if you drill down on that, it does not specifically authorize Charles County to create a transfer tax. So somehow they convinced themselves that they could create a transfer tax, but that's what that was.
Huh.
And there was a lot of yelling and screaming about that in Charles County when they did last year. So.
Yeah, thank you.
So if we're now connected, if we do code home rule and we're now connected to Charles County, they have to approve anything we put in for our county?
Not locally. If the commissioners of St. Mary's County submit a bill locally, we don't have to consult Charles County for that.
Okay, so I misunderstood that they're connected.
And then I'll answer the question. Thank you, okay. Senator. So if we go ahead and we submit a bill locally, and right here in St. Mary's County by the commissioners, and we're code home rule, which does not connect to Charles County. If there is a bill that is specific to St. Mary's County, it does not have to go to Charles County. If it affects a class of counties, then, which a class would be Charles and St. Mary's, then it has to be consulted. So locally.
So if the state did a class.
Right.
It would affect us because it would affect both.
Correct. Yes.
But the state would have to direct it to a class of counties.
Yes, ma'am. Right. So locally, I know. So basically, if it's a class of counties, so if it's Charles and St. Mary's, that's something that would affect both. But if the commissioners are sitting right here and we're passing a bill, say it's a bill for anything, golf carts, because I talked about golf carts a lot, right? No, it does not have to be consulted with Charles County. It's something that's local here, and we take care of it.
Okay, if nothing else, I think we are. We encourage you to stop in the front lobby and take home the materials provided, including the materials in the web address for the Code Home Rule page of the county's website. Their brochure is out there. The web page includes a log of the questions received by citizens to date and the county's responses. Thank you all for being here tonight. Your participation in this process is greatly appreciated. If you have any additional comments or questions, please mail them to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County at Post Office Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650, or email to codehomerule@stmarysmaryland.com. I now close tonight's public hearing.